captives free. You came to bring us liberty. And my sin and my rejection met your blood and my acceptance. Now I'm alive to bring you praise. And where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. And every chain is broken through you, Jesus. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. Whoa.
Good evening. Hello. How are you this evening? Turn to somebody, look at them, say, you're looking mighty fine this evening. Well, if you don't know, this is what we call Mix Sunday night. Now, somebody would look around and they'd say, you know, the mix needs to have a remix. And so we want to tell you what we're planning on doing. Number one, I'm listening to these guys up here, and I'm looking at them while we're doing this, and I'm like, wow. I mean, they are absolutely amazing. Do you agree with me? I mean, they're awesome. And I'm like, God, we got the worship. The thing that we don't have is we don't have what I would call a leader, a director, a pastor over this ministry. And that's been, I believe, one of the big issues. And me and Richard, we're trying. But you know what? I think I left young adulthood a long time ago. And sometimes what I think is really cool, they don't. But we are, this next month on November, we're going to do the last Sunday night of November, and it's going to be a mixed night. We're going to really push it great. We got Jimmy Jackson who's going to be speaking. It's going to be an awesome night. But we're, for the month of November or December, we're going to take that time off because I'm going to meet with all of the young adults, and we are going to hash out a brand new plan for 2017 that's going to give us the ministry and the program that we need and that we want for our church. I think that's good. You ought to clap right there because we're going to really work on this. So what I would like to do is Richard is speaking tonight, and he told me, man, I'm going to be 25, 30 minutes. And I said, okay, if that's the case, then I want to meet in the choir loft right here with every young adult, and I'm going to hold you for 6 minutes. So it's not going to interfere with your baby time or your bath time or your cereal time or if you go to Big Mac McDonald's time. It's not going to interfere with any of that. So I want to meet with you for about 6 minutes. We're going to hash out a schedule and a plan for meeting. And somebody says, well, who are the young adults? Well, 20s, 30s, all the way to 40. If you're over 40, bye-bye, go home. You are not now. Don't leave now. But I would like to meet with those up to 40 years old immediately after the service. Now, did I offend you? I'm terribly sorry. You're the youngest 80-year-old I've ever seen. You know, I'm kidding. I'm totally playing. I just totally offended this lady, and I'm going to have to start all over again. I'm just kidding. Does she have a good sense of humor? Good, good, good. So I want to meet with you in the choir loft immediately after the service for just a few minutes. If you're 40 and under, then I want to meet with you and talk with you for a few minutes. And what I'd like you to do right now, if you don't mind, is I'd like you to get out, find as many people as you can, shake their hands, let them know they're in the right place tonight, and that we're heading towards a great, great ministry and program with The Mix. Thank you for being here.
On this asking for the greater measure. So like the rain come drench us in love, and let your glory rush in like a flood. For we are fixed on this one thing, to know your goodness, see your glory. Oh, we're transformed.
Praise. He's worthy of our worship. Tonight we worship with song, and with the help of the ushers, we're going to worship now with our giving. I learned many years ago that we're never more like him than when we love and we give. His nature, the core of God, is he's a lover and he's a giver. And he made us in his image. So as we love and we give others, we reflect him to the world. Tonight's our opportunity to love him, to give to his ministry, because everything we do here is for him. All the honor and all the praise is his. So let's pray over the offering tonight. Let's pray that the Lord uses this church to reach this generation, the next generation. We want to see the sanctuary full from side to side and front to back with young adults opening their hearts and pouring out their love for God. So let's pray. Lord, we thank you for this opportunity to be here tonight. Lord, we love you. We come because we want to honor your presence, Father. We want to give to you for all that you've given to us. Lord, we pray for this ministry. We pray for the mix. We pray, Lord, that you would fill this sanctuary with people, Lord, with young adults that would passionately pursue you, Father, that would move into a relationship with you. Lord, and we give tonight out of our desire to see this ministry move forward, Father. We ask your blessings over the offering tonight. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen.
Amen. I was praying the other night and just thinking about all the needs that's in, you know, my family alone and in our nation, how we need God so greatly. And just one thing after another just kept coming to my mind, and I just felt so overwhelmed. I felt, my goodness, Lord, there's so much need in my personal life, my family's life, this nation. And he just spoke something to me that says, you can rest in me, but there's still rest in me. And I just thought about, God, I need you. You know, when the darkness comes, when it feels overwhelming, we feel like there's no hope inside, I need you, God. When we're in the valley low, we need him. When we're on the mountaintops, we still need God. We need him in every hour of our life, every minute of our life. And I just begin to think about this, and this song came to my mind. It just says, I need you, God. Nothing, no place, no one else can do. I just need you, God, because you satisfy. You satisfy this longing inside. You satisfy every need. And despite what's going on in our world or in your personal life, God is there. He's in the midst. We can rest in him, and that's so relieving. And so just worship with us tonight. Get our minds on God. We need him so much. God, we love you tonight. God, we lift our burdens to you. We lift, cast all of our cares, all of our anxieties on you, God, because you care for us, God. Thank you, God.
So longs and even faints for you. My heart and my flesh cries out for the living God, for the living God. And incline your ear with trembling and tears of yearning to the throne of grace to seek your face. I'm burning, I'm longing for you. And I need you,
I need you,
I need you.
I need nothing, no place, no one else will do.
I need you,
I need you,
I need you.
Oh, and you satisfy this longing inside. No place, no one else will do.
I need you,
I need you,
and I need you,
I need you.
Oh, and you satisfy this longing inside.
Da 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 da.
Even faints for you, only you, God. In my heart, in my flesh, it cries out for the living God, for the living God. Oh, and incline your ear with trembling and tears of yearning. Oh, yes. Oh, into the throne of grace to seek your face. I'm burning, I'm longing for you. And I need you,
I need you,
I need you.
Oh, in nothing, no place, no one else will do.
I need you,
I need you,
I need you,
I need you.
Oh, and you satisfy this longing inside. I need you,
no one else will do.
I need you,
I need you,
and I need you.
through the darkness and loneliness, I need you, God. In the valley low, on the mountains high, we still need you, God. And when the darkness strikes, leaves no hope inside, oh, we need you, God.
Greater than all names.
above every name, your name is greater, and be lifted up. Oh, yes, and be lifted higher, and be lifted up, be lifted. Sing praises to your name, praises to your name, the name that's so much higher than all names. We give you praise, we give you honor, and all honor to
That I am yours and you are mine. We're bringing back the joy of salvation.
Oh, in this day and age, God.
We're bringing back the joy of salvation. That I am yours and you are mine. We're bringing back the joy of salvation.
Oh, we're bringing it back, Lord.
We're bringing back the joy of salvation. That I am yours and you are mine. We're bringing back the joy of salvation.
Oh, I'm glad to be yours, God.
We're bringing back the joy of salvation. That I am yours and you are mine. We're bringing back the joy of salvation.
Oh, to you, Lord.
We're bringing back the joy of salvation.
Night and day, let incense arise, God. Oh, day and night, night and day.
Amen. Amen. God is so faithful and God is so good. I want to challenge you tonight with this thought as we begin. God is in the business of building our confidence. God does things in our life and touches our hearts in a service like this where he shows up and he moves. It's awesome how he can show you the truth and he can show you the reality. You get in touch with how awesome and how strong he is. He can break open the word and show you something and build confidence, build faith in you. That's what God does. He shows himself mighty and he shows himself to us. And I want you to be encouraged to grab hold of whatever he would speak to you tonight, whatever you felt from the praise and worship, how he's touched you. I would walk out of here with confidence knowing that we serve a God that's able, a God that's mighty. And even when we don't know the whole story or understand the whole truth and we don't know what's all going on, we need to have confidence that he sees it all and knows it all and he's able to take care of us and watch out for us. We serve an awesome, an incredible, and mighty, a wonderful, a magnificent God that loves us and that wants to take care of us and wants to be God in our life. He is so awesome and so wonderful, so incredible. God is so good. I'm going to be sharing with you tonight from Genesis chapter 26. And we'll jump into this just a little bit. I'll read just a little bit of it. Starting verse 26, this is in the Amplified. It says, "And there was a famine in the land, other than the former famine that was in the days of Abraham. And Isaac went to Gerar to Abimelech, king of the Philistines. And the Lord appeared to him and said, 'Do not go down to Egypt. Live here in the land which I will tell you.'" We're going to stop right there. Let's just pray. Dear Heavenly Father, in the name of Jesus, we pray that you would be with us tonight and share with us, speak to us your words. God, what you would want us to hear and know, what you would want to have us walk out of here in confidence with, I pray that you would speak that and be that tonight in the name of Jesus. I pray that you would take care of us. Amen and amen. God bless y'all. You can be seated. We live in a changing world. Doug, you can turn me down up here. I hate hearing myself, so let's go ahead and take care of that. But anyhow, the title of the message tonight, The Family Business. I was going to put that on the poster and stuff out in the lobby, then I've realized, I thought about it, you know, usually when somebody says the family business, that means they're a mobster, and that might be a negative connotation. So I said, well, I'm going to call it The Family Tree. But anyhow, I want to focus tonight on the family and what that means as a young adult. We live in a changing world. The country we are in now, even 10 years ago, we almost can't recognize. The things that once we thought would never happen are happening at an alarming rate. Our moral fabric seems to be tearing on all sides. We are in a tough election season, and that seems to bring it all to the surface. We are living in a time where we have to go back to God's word and what he's called us to be. There's pressures on us from the world, and if we're not careful, we'll crack under the pressure. And what I want to start with this is talking about the family, and I'm going to connect the two here in just a second. I believe that there's advantages and there's gifts that God's given us through our family and through our raising that we need to latch onto and grab hold of. In a young adult's life, it's easy for situations and things to come along where we kind of loosen our grip on where we've come from and the way we have done things because we feel all kinds of different adversity, so we kind of walk away from those things. But I want to focus on this. I want to focus on the advantages of where we've come from. Focus on the advantages of where we come from, and hopefully God will be right in the middle of this, and he'll speak through me, he'll speak through his word, and he'll show you things that are valuable that maybe we forgot about, or maybe, you know, we kind of let go, and maybe we didn't have confidence in, but things that he wants to bring back to the surface to remind you of, that we can walk out of here with confidence. Starting here, Genesis 1:1 says this, "In the beginning God created the heavens and the earth." If you take this world and break it down to its simplest forms, you can see there's building blocks that God himself has put in place that make this world what it is. But just at the same time, you can see those very things being the things that the enemy attacks and he wants to tear down, take them away from the building blocks that they were, to turn them into something that seems like, well, that's not the truth, or that's broken, or that's a messed up system that doesn't work. The enemy wants to discredit the very things that God has set in motion for this world. He wants to tear them down and ruin them. Let me give you an example. Truth. There's truth in this world. But if you look at a world that we live in nowadays, truth has been beat down. It's been taken advantage of. It's been disclaimed so many times that we almost give up on anything that's a truth. Turn on Facebook, listen to an election ad. People can look at you right in the face and smile, and you cannot trust that is the truth whatsoever. We have a culture where we don't believe what anybody says. Everything, we're kind of like, that's what you think. And I believe that's a design that the enemy has attacked truth. Because in this world, we need to have absolutes, but we have an enemy that says, oh, no, you can't say that there's right and wrong. You can't say that there's something you can build on. No, that's false. That's man-made. That's a lie. And we're suffering for it. God has given us life. But if you ask a certain person, they'll say, no, life doesn't begin until after you come out of the womb. If you're still in the womb, no, that's not life. The definition has been changed. The definition of not speaking in legal terms or election terms, the definition of marriage has been changed. Once where God said, there's a man and there will be a woman and they'll come together, that's changed. It's like somebody saying, hey, you doesn't have to be that way. That's wrong. God wasn't thinking when he said that. You know, love can be any way you want it to be. Woman with woman, man with man. And I know people are affected by that in this church. My family's been affected by it. But I'm just saying that there's an attack on marriage. It even goes so far as God said, there's male and female. That's under attack. That's under attack nowadays. People will stand up and say, hey, I look like a man, but really there's a female inside here. And you better not say anything about it because you're going to be the bad guy. It's the very building blocks that God has set in motion that are attacked, even down to love. And I'll get into this a little bit more deeper. Love seems to be something that's changed. The definition of love has changed. It seems to be something that the normal world now says, man, that's too much effort. That's too much work. You know, all that work and you can't get nothing out of it. You know, take care of yourself. Do the best you can. Get what's yours. And then that's how it works. Even the definition of love has changed in the world we live in. And it goes on down the line from our church to our pastors to any different thing. Stuff that God has said, this is how it should be, has been attacked, been ripped down. And one of the biggest things that I want to talk about tonight is family. Family has changed. And let me throw this out as a disclaimer. I'm going to talk about family, and I'm going to talk about it in its most traditional sense. I'm not saying it to offend anybody or make your situation look bad or anything like that. I just want you to see it as the basic building block of life, as God intended it to be. Family is under attack. Family was designed to be this place where people would come together. They would love, and out of that love, they would be able to create children, and family would take on the sense of a home, a place that's safe, a place where you can find love, you can find support, you can raise kids. Kids are raised up to know the difference between right and wrong. They're taught discipline. It's a place where they find out what love really is, maybe by watching mom and dad. They find out that love is real and that love works, but it's been under attack. It's been under attack. And I got to thinking about that. The reason why it's under attack, I thought about my situation. I'm raising my son. He comes to church. He's in the school here. And he can quote probably, he's up to about 8 or 10 scriptures. And I thought about him. And I thought about, why would the enemy attack family? Why would he attack the kids of pastors? Why would he attack good Christian folks' as kids? And why would it be so hard? That's because the enemy knows something. He knows how powerful this word is. He knows how powerful the prayers that you walked the floor at night and prayed. He knows how powerful when they see mom and dad get up and talk about the Lord. He knows how powerful that can be in somebody's life. He understands how powerful it is, and he's doing his best and scrambles to snatch that away. I've got to get that. I want you to know that in the right situation, kids have such an advantage when they find themselves growing up in church, when they find parents that will love them, that will take care of them, that will give them the word. They have such an advantage because there's so much power in God's word and in God's presence. The enemy is after situations like that. He wants to disrupt the family and discount those kind of things and tear it apart. He wants to pull those things down. Now, let me say this, and like I said, this is young adults. Let's talk to some young marrieds, old marrieds, I don't know, whatever. I ask this question, and maybe you've, every once in a great while, you ask yourself this. You might say, why is it so hard? Why is it so hard to be in a married relationship and to make it work? Just about the time we think it's good and it's okay, boom, there's something else, and we just fight and fight and fight and fight. Ugh. This is the reason why it's so hard, because you have an enemy that's after that relationship, that family, because he knows that there is built-in advantages in that are going to touch people's lives, that are going to bless people's lives, that speak of God's creative power, that speak of the very building blocks of life. The enemy wants to destroy the relationships that you have. He wants to destroy family and take away those advantages. So I say this, take a deep breath, give yourself a break, give yourself a break. Step back and look at your spouse, look at your family, and just be like, you know what, it doesn't necessarily have to be them. It doesn't have to be your wife that won't leave you alone, or your husband that's a jerk, or whatever your situation is. The people that are closest to you, that love you, it doesn't have to be that they're the worst people ever. It's that enemy. Understand the enemy is attacking. Understand the enemy wants to pull away from you the very things that God has given you. If you could brush him out of the situation, of course, we're all not perfect and we're all growing. But if we could brush him out of the picture for a second and just see how things really are, I guarantee you our relationships would be different. Our home would be different. So I want us just to see that the family is under attack. A family is under attack. Why is there so much divorce? Why is there so much divorce in the church? It's because you have an enemy that's after you. God's design is the family. Pray for it. Pray for it. Understand God is for you. Get your head in the game. Wake up and realize that you're under attack. Stop looking around. Since you feel so bad about things, stop looking around to see if there's anything better out there. God is for you. He wants to use and work in your family. He wants to help you and take care of you. So when we look at young adults and family, Isaac had a situation here where a famine had come up. And he responded and he said, I'm going to go to Egypt. Because that's, you know, we can get substance there. I'm going to go to Egypt. God stopped him. You know, and Isaac kind of had it in his head that he would go to Egypt, because when there was a famine and Abraham was in the situation, that's where he went. But God stopped him and said, hey, don't go there. And he gave him a reason why. And see, the cool thing about the situation is Isaac needed to respond like his dad did, not by going the place he went, but by taking on the attitude and obeying God like Abraham did. But anyhow, you see that he's in a place of transition. And young adults, we are in that place. We go from a place of, you know, graduating, starting college. We see life with potential. We have hopes and dreams. We have this plan that we're going to go and get. And then there's sometimes somewhere down the road, when we're into it a little while, we've all been there. We feel lonely. We kind of feel lost. We kind of feel frustrated. Your excitement turns to defeat. Your potential seems to be wasted doing some job that you hate. I've been there. I worked at Myers for Myers over here in town for like 9 years. And the time when I really felt like, man, I'm wasting my energies here, is when I had to switch the trash bags out of the trash cans around the store. Now, about 1,000 people drop trash in the trash cans a day, and they don't think for a second about what they're throwing in there. So I would go and change the trash cans, and it would be sitting full of liquid about this deep, which is everything that you could imagine it was that full of, and then diapers and, you know, Lord knows what was in there. And I changed those, we call them bullet cans. I changed those things, and I was like, oh, I hated that job. I hated that job. People would be like, what's that smell? And I'd be like, that's me. I just changed trash cans. It's called Essence of Garbage. It's a new cologne that I wear. But there's no worse smell than pop and coffee and cigarette ashes and stuff all mixed together. Anyhow, I imagine if there's a smell in the bad place, it's very similar to that. But anyhow, we all find ourselves in those places where we're in this transition, young adults, and we can easily begin to look at our situations about how we were raised and where we came from and begin to just be like, well, I'm out here now, and I've just got to make it on my own. We can step away from what was important or how we've been raised. You know, not that we necessarily step away from God, but we step away from some of the principles and how they handle things, and we just feel like, okay, we got to start over and do our thing. There are times when we feel all these different things. Your dreams can become the thing that you used to want to do. It's tempting to let go of all the stuff that you've learned from your family and how you were raised. Oh, man, I got to hurry up and get through this. Tonight, we're going to start over. We're going to talk about how we were raised, and we're going to pull out the good stuff, because I believe that we're raised on purpose. I believe that there's situations that we've gone through, that we've been through, that will give us tools that will help us to live our life, and sometimes we discredit them, but we're going to point back at them. Let's talk a little bit. Okay, number one, I want you to think about, you probably wasn't raised in a perfect situation. I wasn't. You probably weren't. There's divorce. There's sickness. You're raised with other family members. Maybe you weren't raised with your natural parents. Maybe someone was abusive to you. There's all kinds of situations that were not perfect. So I say this to that. No one was raised perfect. Some people would say, I grew up perfect, even though the definition of perfect didn't really apply to your situation. God has a way of sending the right people. I have great parents, but I've also got a great pastor that was sent in my life at a young age that's helped me for years and years and years. Then at the end of the day, I say this. Romans 8 and 28 says, and we know that all things work together for the good of those who love God, to those who are called according to his purpose. So I believe that there's things that we've been raised in that we can look back on and use now in our life to help us to tackle life. I was really thirsty. I had to drink twice. Okay, so this is what we're going to think of our families. We're going to think of how we were raised. Now, what we like to do is, especially as we're getting older, you know, the wisdom button kicks in up here, and we really start thinking about, man, you know, this was bad. I wish they would have done this. You know, I've told people before, man, I wish my parents would have kind of raised me like this so I would be more like this. We're really good at pointing out all the negatives, but tonight we're going to point out the positives. We are going to look at the positives and let God use those things in our lives, the positives, and not a laundry list of negatives. Genesis 26 and 1, and this is just a great story of father and son, Abraham and Isaac, and we're going to pull our tools, so to speak, from that. Genesis 26 and 1 says, there was a famine in the land besides the first famine that was in the days of Abraham, and Isaac went to Abimelech, king of the Philistines, in Gerar. Then the Lord appeared to him and said, do not go down to Egypt. Live in the land which I shall tell you. Dwell in this land, and I will be with you. I will bless you. For to you and your descendants I will give all these lands, and I will perform an oath which I swore to Abraham your father, and I will make your descendants multiply as the stars of heaven. I will give your descendants these lands, and your seed to all the nations of the earth shall be blessed. Because Abraham obeyed my voice, kept my charge, my commandments, my statutes, and my laws. Incredible, incredible, incredible. I believe that you were raised in the situation you were because there were some things that you were going to get in your raising. There was some transfers, some things that were going to be passed down, some blessings that you now have in your hands, and maybe you don't even realize them. We're calling them tools. And some of this is 5 seconds. Hey, this is what it is. And then some of it's just a little bit more in depth. But Genesis 1:20. I said 1:22, but I don't think it is. It's actually 26:22. It says, and he moved from there and dug another well, and they did not quarrel over it. So he called its name Rehoboth, because he said, for now the Lord has made room for us, and we shall be fruitful in the land. What happens is Isaac, he's blessed so much that the people of the land come to him and say, you got to get out of here. We're tired of you being here. They were envious, and they were just like, you're going to have to move. So he moves, and he moves to the valley of Gerar, however you say it. He moves to the valley, and he starts over. He digs up all the wells of Abraham, then he starts digging more wells and more wells. And if I can, the reason why I talk about the wells is because it was, in a sense, Abraham was known for these wells, and Isaac starts digging these other wells, and they're just, there's everywhere he goes, it seems like he's just digging wells and wells and wells, and they're just blessed. And it finally even says that the Lord has made room for us to be fruitful in the land because of the wells. And I want to say this, it's young adults, of older generation, you've already figured this out. But one of the best things that we can have in the situation we were raised, we've been taught skills. We have skills. We have certain things. Maybe they frustrate you, and you're like, I'm not going to work in the factory like my dad. But maybe you're in a situation right now where you're blessed to know how to do that, to make that happen, that you've had the skills that have been passed down. But more than that, what I want you to see is, and it's harder to take inventory of, is the very things that the people that raised you, the people that are around you, the very good things that those people are noted for, they might be the very things that you excel at. They've been passed on to you. The skills have been passed on to you. Cameron, if you talk to him for a little bit, he'll talk about his dad, and his dad never meets a stranger, and that he's, you know, talking to everybody that comes around, and he's a great talker and a great relationship builder. He's a great connector. Well, Cameron is that. And I don't know if he set out to do that. Hey, I want to be like my dad. But because of his situation growing up with him, he's a great connector. He loves people. He loves relationships and connecting with people. Look for the skills that you've been blessed with because of the situation that you're in. That's one of the tools that will help you excel. Young adult, that's one of the tools that will help you excel in your life. The second one is this. Pay attention to the spiritual disciplines of the people that are around you. Now, I know maybe you might say, hey, my dad was this and my mom is this or whatever, but look for those people that you admire. Look for those people that have been around you as you've been raised, and they excelled in prayer. They took time to read their Bible. Look for those things, the disciplines that they dug out and made happen, and follow them. There's people in this church that will forever pray a certain way because they've watched the pastor do it a certain way. They fell in love with the word because they heard Marty preach a sermon. Look for those things, those keys and those tools, those disciplines that will help you excel in your life. And the scripture here, and it says, I will make your descendants multiply as the stars of heaven. This beautiful promise that's given to Isaac, just like it was given to Abraham, it ends with this, and it says, because Abraham obeyed my voice, kept my charge, my commands, my statutes, my laws. Isaac knew spiritual disciplines from being around his father. He saw them in practice, and he saw them work out. If no other experience, the sacrifice would speak so loud to him. He watched. He saw how they how he took care of things. You've watched people. You saw how they took care of the word, how they praised God, how they handled things in prayer and saw it through to a victory. Take those things that you've been given and use them. And if it's, like I said, if it's not your mom or your dad, it's a pastor, it's somebody at church, it's somebody that's giving. Now, this is a little bit deeper, but I believe this with all my heart. If you go back in Genesis, there's a situation where Abraham says, he talks to God and he says, but I don't have an heir. He's talking to God. And in a sense, he's praying, he's asking, I don't have an heir. God responds to him and gives him these promises and says, talks about the stars of the sky and promises these things. Abraham asks a question and God answers. I want to know, and we all have it, you know, we struggle in life. And we think, is anybody out there, you know, I've got so much up against me, so much I'm going through. But I want you to stop and think for a second. Who is praying for you? Who is praying for you? Is your mom praying for you? Is your dad praying for you? I know the pastor is praying for you. I want you to stop and think about all the people that are praying for you in your life. They want to see you succeed. They want to see you get the right job. They want to see you marry the right person. They want to see you blessed. They want to see God do something incredible in your life. And there's a whole list of people that are praying for you, that are just shouting. Who knows? Who knows all the people that have walked the floor at night and prayed over you and prayed and said, God, I just want them to be blessed. I want this. I want that. God, I want the best for them. I'm going to totally spin this different than I've ever thought of it before. But I believe it's so true. I believe the pastor has done this for me. I believe that he's prayed the will of God for my life. And that check this out. And I believe with all my heart that if I'm obedient to God, if he's obedient in his prayer, and I'm obedient to God, then God will answer his prayer in my life. That God will begin to do a work, begin to clear a path, that if I'll be obedient, that God will, if he prays according to God's will, God's going to start blessing and start moving if I walk in obedience. Now, my question is, who's praying for you? You know the people that love you and care for you, that pray for you, they haven't just been like, whatever. They've been praying for the very things that you've wanted, the very things that you've needed in your life. And if you'll be obedient and say, God, this is crazy, but I'm going to trust you. I believe that God's going to answer the prayers of the people that pray for you in your life. And maybe you haven't even thought about it that way. But I've watched as a pastor has got up and he said, the Lord spoke to him and said, you're still running on the prayers of your mom. And I believe that absolutely to be true. It just totally changes everything if he's obedient and I'm obedient. If your parents have been obedient and prayed according to God's will, if you fall in line with that, you're going to be blessed. God went to Isaac and said the same thing. Hey, Abraham got a promise, and it was fulfilled in his life because he did exactly what he was supposed to do. He followed my commandments. He obeyed me. If you'll do the same thing, if you'll listen to my word, if you'll listen and follow my commandments, the same promise, the same blessing, so to speak, that was there, they're going to be yours. And that completely changes everything because you start thinking about it and you're like, okay, God, what is out there? What has been prayed over my life? Who knows the situations that you might be facing? But God, use somebody to pray for you and to intervene in the situation. And that's a tool for us. That's a tool for us to know that somebody's there for us. Somebody loves us. And the prayers are making a difference in our own heart and life if we will listen and be obedient. That's not us expelling the energy. That's somebody else doing it for us, clearing a path and clearing a way. They've been praying good things. They've been praying for you. I want us to understand this and want us to get it. And the last thing is just a step beyond that. We have the tool of the skills that have been passed down to us. We have the tool of the spiritual disciplines that we've been given. We have the tool of knowing that somebody has paved a way for us and prayed a way for us, that if we'll be obedient, we can walk it. And the last one is simply this. It's kind of a step beyond the last one, is that potentially, when you were being raised, God spoke a promise over your family. And the promise will potentially is yours if you will listen and be obedient. I'm not saying that you go to your parents or, you know, the person that raised you and said, hey, give me a promise or whatever. But I do say this. There may be a promise over your family that's yours. If you pray it out and look for it, maybe ask your parents or ask whoever and pray it and say, is this for me? Let God confirm it in his word, obviously. But there could very well be, like for Isaac, there could be promises over your life. And, of course, there's promises in the scripture already. You're not out there by yourself just clawing and trying to make it happen. Oh, man, we're almost done here. So anyhow, let's tie this up here. So if we look at our situation in our life, we look at where we've come from and pull out all the good stuff. You know what? I do have some things here that God's blessed me with. He's taught me this and taught me this and taught me this. So you have all those things now at your disposal. So what do? We get busy. Because just like they've been passed to you and somebody's loved you and taken care of you, they've prayed over you, they've showed you how to read the word, showed you how to live, showed you how to make through life, just like they've done on that thing, there's a world that you're supposed to dig some wells for. There's a world that now you're supposed to turn around and be a blessing, to pray over people's lives, to touch people's lives and help them and be there for them. You know, if you want to know, like, man, where do I go from here? What do? I'm just getting into this life. I'm just trying to get my handle on things. Get busy with the things that you've been given. And that, what is the reward? I can tell you this is the reward. Now, I've shared this story before, and I'm going to share it again, and maybe it'll be My Hair Arena. I don't know. Got the pastor's attention. My son was born 10 weeks early. He was in the hospital for 7 weeks. Then he went, as soon as he was born, they put him in this clear box, you know, with all these tubes and electrodes and Lord knows whatever. And I got up the first morning after he was born. And I went, actually, it was the first time I saw him. I looked in this clear box, and I saw him laying there. And all of a sudden, I went into dad mode, like panicked. Like, okay, God, I'm going to pray for him, and I'm just going to rake myself over the coals. I'm going to kill myself, and I'm going to be super dad, and I'm going to make this happen. The Lord spoke back to me, and he said this. He said, I'm going to be with him like I've been with you. And that... I was just like, that was not in my mind. That wasn't in my thoughts. But immediately I went to time and time and time again where God, either I knew it or I didn't, but God intervened in my life. And it didn't matter how worried I was or how worried I wasn't. God showed up and moved wonderfully and brought me to the place where I am. But I'm looking in that box and I'm just like, you're going to be there with him. Now check this out. God spoke that as a promise to me. A worried dad, he spoke that as a promise to me. But I can tell you with no doubt that all through his life, that little guy, I can tell you that time and time again, I can see favor. I can see such blessings on him. Not that it's him, so don't think, hey, my son's better than yours. That's not what this is about. But what it is I see favor. I see God fulfilling the promise that he gave me. I see him fulfilling it in his life. So if you'll stand with me, let's just shut this down now. What our altar is just going to be about tonight is asking the question, what have you been given and who do I need to give it to? What have I been given and who do I need to give it to? And I don't want you to feel guilty, because sometimes in this kind of altar, you know, in this kind of response, you know, we'll say, well, who do you need to be taken care of out there? And you feel like, oh, man, I feel like garbage because I know I need to do this, this, and this. Don't worry about that. God has blessed you. Who do you need to bless? Who do you need to minister to? If you'd bow your heads, close your eyes. The cool thing about it is, you know, it's kind of like family and how you're raised. Before this moment and before this day, Jesus was sent to this world to die on a cross, to pay for our sins, to pave a way for the generations that would be coming, because he knew that God knew that we'd be coming in sin and that we'd need a Savior. So out of God's love, he sent his Son to die on the cross for us, to pay a price for us, so that if we accept him, we could have freedom and live the life that God intended for us. If there's anybody here tonight that would just like to pray a prayer that would respond to that, would say, yes, I want to accept Jesus into my life, his sacrifice, so that I'll be saved, so that I'll know what this life is really supposed to be about. Is there anybody at all that would want to pray? There's one. Is there anybody else? Jesus is paving a way for you. You might feel frustrated about life and disappointed so many people, and you've consider that maybe you've made a mess of things. You know you need a Savior. Jesus has come to pave a way. He is that Savior sent by God. Is there anybody else that would want to pray? Okay, we're going to pray. You just believe in your heart. Repeat after me. You will be saved. Dear Heavenly Father, in the name of Jesus, I confess I'm a sinner. I needed a Savior. Jesus, you were that Savior. You were sent from God as his only beloved Son to pay a price for me, that if I accept you, I'll be washed clean. I will be saved. Now I'll be ready to receive you and the life you have for me. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. The challenge is, what have you been given? And who are you going to take it to? Pastor, if you'll come.
I want you, if you would, just for a few moments, if you're able to just step into the altar and let's have prayer together. Bring your family. It's important what he's saying. And with the message I got and I gleaned from this tonight is that you don't realize how important the responsibility that God is giving you to live out your Christian experience in your family. Moms, dads, young marrieds, young adults, young people who are getting ready to be married. You're not married yet. You want to be. Kids, you know, you think about all the responsibilities that you have and all the things that God wants to do. Really, if he could put a new title on the message, I think it would be, who's in your shadow? Who are you responsible for? God's giving you the ability. He's giving you the anointing. He's giving you, if he has brought you children, if he's brought you the desire for children, if he's brought you a wife, if you have a husband, if you have those things, if you have that desire for that, then God is anointing you. Carmen used to sing that song, your desire is the confirmation, the destination is there. If you've got something burning down in your heart and you've got love around you, you've come from love, you've been given those tools, you've been given those abilities, all those things. Maybe your mom and daddy were just spiritual giants. That has come through them into your life, and now it must pass through to others. Starts with the family. But then, you know, he wasn't my family. But as a young man, when he first walked in, you know, God dropped him down in my heart, and I knew I was responsible for him. And boy, what a responsible thing it was. He had hair all the way down to here, headbands. He was covered in drawings all over both of his arms. And you'd say, hi there, hi, my name is Ray. And he's just like, for about a year or two, he didn't do anything but just go. I had to learn a whole new language. But you know, God looked down on that young man that was raised in the country of Germantown and had never really been to anywhere but Burger King, and took that young man who had so much, you know, ahead of him and so much potential inside of him, and God raised up a giant out of him. I mean, the only reason I point out the hair and the headbands and the way that he, you know, barely communicated was because look how far he's come. And I'm proud of him, and I'm proud of what God has done in his life. God wants to use you to minister to others. He wants you to be anointed to touch others. You're given a responsibility for that. So who's in your shadow? Who's in your shadow tonight? Who are you praying for right now? Who is in there? Who are you thinking about? Surely you're thinking of someone. If not, then what are you going to do about it? We got to make a difference. We're saved to make a difference. Can you say amen? We're saved to make a difference. And so you have that responsibility tonight. We're going to pray. We're going to pray for families. We're going to pray for people. We're going to pray for the anointing on your life that has come down through your family that has come to you. Maybe you didn't grow up in a Christian home, but you got a church family, and God has brought you to this place, and now you're anointed to pass it on. It starts with you. So either way, no matter what, you're empowered right now to do a great thing for God. And that's an awesome thing, that God is anointing you right now to do an amazing thing in someone else's life. Are you ready? Then we're going to pray right now. Lord, empower us for your service. Empower us to make a difference. Lord, let us be anointed right now from this night to go and do intentional relationships with everyone that you've given us in our sphere of influence right now. You ready? Let's pray. Father, we come to you. We thank you as a church family, as a mixed ministry tonight. God, this message touches our heart. It helps us to see, God, the accountability and the responsibility that lies upon us. I pray for young adults, God, maybe those that have come from Christian families. I thank you for the heritage they have. I thank you for the anointing that's been passed down, the promises that are being lived out. I pray that you will empower them tonight, that they will feel that anointing on their lives to carry on the work that you've started in their families and in their lives, that you're continuing through them. And Lord, I pray for young adults. I pray for folks that didn't come from a Christian family. It kind of starts with them. That's all right. Lord, we ask you now, anoint them, empower them, give them that desire down inside of them to make a difference, to make a family out of wherever they have influence and whatever you're doing to let the plan that you're working in their lives to unfold. I pray for that anointing. I pray for that ministry. I pray for that accountability. I pray for the children that are going to come blessed out of this service tonight. I pray for young men, young ladies that are going to develop and be discipled because of this message tonight. I pray, God, for those that are in our shadow, that God, you will anoint us to make a difference in each of their lives. We thank you for this. We accept this. And Lord, we're ready for it. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. And everyone together said, amen. Amen. God bless you tonight. Do you feel that accountability? Do you feel that responsibility? You're hugging on one of yours. God's given you that. And we all have someone in our shadow. If you know of somebody in your shadow, I want to see your hand right now. I got somebody in my shadow. Amen. Amen. All right. God bless you. If you're a young adult, 40 and under, would you meet me in the choir loft for a really quick meeting right away? God bless you.